Hey, so today I wanted to talk to you about my super micro storage server, which is right behind me. It's been pretty gutted, but I think it has a potential to be a pretty decent storage server.
My guy, what the f*** are you talking about? This server has 15-year-old CPUs. The only decent thing you can do with it is to throw it out. Let's start at the beginning though. This is a SunFire Tor, a system designed specifically with ZFS in mind. It can house up to 48 drives and runs two 6-core AMD Opteron processors with a total of 32 gigs of RAM. Even after 14 years, it's not that bad, especially considering it has PCI Express capabilities and 4 1 gigabit network interfaces. Don't confuse it with the Tamper. Those are slightly weaker in spec and have PCIe-X based I.O., which is something I am completely unfamiliar with. Apart from that, they look almost identical. Both of those SunFires have one big disadvantage though. They don't support drives bigger than 2 TB. But then I got this super micro handed to me and immediately I got some ideas, like putting my old PC motherboard in it. I just thought it would be a fun experiment, and you know what? It actually did work. I even measured power usage and in hindsight, it wasn't all that bad. But more on that later. I didn't pursue it further, mostly because the chassis doesn't have the rivets lined up for ATX motherboard. If you have some suggestions or ideas on how to tackle this, I'm open for comments. Anyway, after I put the original motherboard back in, I've repasted the CPUs. This super micro system has 4 AMD Opteron 6168 processors and 256 gigs of DDR3 ECC memory. But the best thing about it is that it supports SAS drives. Even if you replace the motherboard with additional PCI Express card, you can enjoy the benefits of SAS drives. One thing I didn't want to do was to install the OS on one of the drives in the front. So I decided to buy PCI Express to NVMe adapter. But it didn't work. Turns out that this system is so old it doesn't support UEFI and thus doesn't even see NVMe as a bootable option in the BIOS. You can boot USB Linux installer and install the system onto NVMe, it's just that BIOS doesn't see it as a bootable option. Some of you were quick to point out during one of my lives on TikTok that an additional small USB with grub installed onto it would fix the problem. But I didn't like the idea of having an essential component of the system split into two equally important parts. And yes, I do slightly different content on the other platforms, so if you're interested, check out this video description.
Yeah, I mean, fuck this.
But going back to the topic, I bought another, similar pass-through, this time with M.2 SATA output. You may ask yourself why I even bother with PCI Express pass-throughs. Well, the system has no extra Molex or SATA power cables available, so in order for everything to nicely fit, I'm basically using this card only to power my M.2 SATA disk. Oh yeah, I also tried this, but only USB 2.0 was available. Speeds were slow, and you can probably guess I didn't like the drive dangling within or outside of the chassis.
After everything was set up, I installed the Debian stable.
Then I was able to properly measure baseline power usage and thermals, so let's talk about it now. This box has 3 1kW PSUs. Those alone consume about 75 watts, before even powering on the system, just for their fans spinning. Going back for a second to my old PC motherboard, with an Intel i3-8100, it consumed 140 watts. But you already knew that if you are watching my shorts or follow me on other platforms. With the original board back in, I turned on the system without any HDDs, and during boot, power usage peaked at 730 watts, but afterwards stabilized at around 440. During stress test, however, I've registered around 660 watts. Remember, this is without any hard drives even inserted. Weirdly enough, the CPU temperatures didn't exceed 40 degrees Celsius, so either this new thermal paste does wonders, or the onboard temperature probes are broken? I'm not sure. But enough about the hardware. I've inserted some drives, and now you're probably thinking, how am I going to organize all of this space? And ZFS, BTRFS, software write, those are things that probably come to your mind, but no. I wanted to try something different.
Ceph represents a software-defined approach to distributed storage systems. With Ceph, you don't need hardware RAID cards or any specialist equipment. You don't even need matching hard drive types and sizes. You just grab anything you have on hand and you can configure a cluster. What's even more interesting, with Ceph you can expose your storage in any way you'd like. That means you can share it as a file system via NFS, but you can also expose it as a block device or even S3 object gateway.
First, install dependencies. Ceph by default recommends Podman, and I was surprised it was available in a fairly recent version in the most of the package repositories. Then, install Ceph IDM. It's an utility to help create and manage clusters. Give it exec attribute. Use Ceph admin to add Ceph package repositories and install Ceph admin itself onto your system. So I completely forgot that this install command actually fails, and it fails because it does not create the home directory for the Ceph ADM user. So I'm gonna show you how to fix that. We simply need to create the directory by itself, change the ownership, and then change the attributes. After that, just manually up install the Ceph ADM. Okay, back to our scheduled programming. Install Ceph common and Ceph base. First one gives us Ceph command. Second provides us with crash tool. Now, bootstrap the Ceph cluster. Use your own IP address. After it's done, you'll see a summary message with an URL and the admin password. It might be your non-FQDN hostname, so just substitute it with the server's IP address. A lovely web panel welcomes you. We are almost done. The single host defaults option, from what I've experienced, only applies to replicated type pools. If you want to use erasure coding, you'll need to tweak the crash map. In order to do that, let's go back to the CLI. Get the crash map and convert it to readable text. At the end of that file, there should be a rule section for both replicated and erasure coding pools. Change any occurrence of type host to type OSD. You might not see the rules without creating a pool first. In that case, either write them in or just create an EC type pool beforehand. Finally, compile the crash map and update the cluster. As you can see, it was really quick to get everything up and running. One thing though, Ceph says to not mount shares on the same host as the server. This also applies to containers. You cannot use single kernel to both expose and mount shares. You can have a VM with Ceph client inside though. For now, I've added the NFS server feature to my node and mounted the exposed CephFS on another Linux host. Everything seems to work fairly decently.
Hey, so it's editing me. I forgot to record the outro when I was next to the hardware. So, thanks for watching. And if you have any questions, I thought it would be a good idea if you write comments and then I will maybe make a Q&A. Because I realized that Ceph and this hardware are not easy, easy subjects to create a consistent and coherent material about. So, once again, like, subscribe, thank you for watching, and I hope I'll see you next time. Bye.